in March of 2013 at age 42. Before her appointment, Judge Frison has practiced locally and abroad as the owner of Frison Law Firm, PC, with a focus on criminal law and military justice. Judge Frison spent nearly 7 years as a litigation associate prior to the opening of her own firm. Judge Frison graduated from Hyde Park Career Academy in 1988 and earned her bachelor's degree in government from Harvard University and Radcliffe College in 1992. She received her Juris Doctorate from Georgetown University Law Center in 1995. She holds the rank Major in the United States Marine Corps and is Marine Corps Judge Advocate. In addition to serving the country and practicing law, she has served as Gruberman Teaching Fellow at Brandeis University for 3 years, teaching Introduction to Law, as well as appearing as a guest lecturer at Brandeis on Military Justice and Military Tribunals. She's a past president of MA Masters of Black Judges Conference.
Some of the social justice issues that I contend with in my work. I'm 52 years old. I'll be 53 next month. You'll get here at some point. It's a struggle, but you will get here. I've been a judge in Massachusetts for 14 years. My family is in Mississippi. I grew up in Chicago on the South Side. I was the valedictorian at my high school. And that was Hyde Park in Chicago. From there, I went on to Harvard, came up this way in 1992. I graduated from Harvard and went straight to Georgetown for law school. I joined the Marine Corps while I was in law school, in the summer after my second year. So I went to Officer Candidate School in 1994, and then went on to the Basic School in 1996. Between those schools, I was a prosecutor here in Norfolk County in the District Attorney's Office, and I went on to active duty from there. I served in North Carolina at Marine Corps Air Station New River as a prosecutor. I've also served in Quantico, Virginia, Okinawa, Japan, Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. I've spent 7 years after that tour of duty here in Massachusetts working for a firm in Boston as a litigation associate. And in 2009, I came onto the bench at the Boston Municipal Court. I've been appointed to two courts in Massachusetts, the Boston Municipal Court and now the Superior Court, where I now sit. And still, I've been accused of being a gang member 2 times. The first time, I was representing a sailor in Okinawa, Japan. I had left the firm. I had opened my own shop in downtown Boston, right at 60 State Street, and I represented a bunch of people during that period, one of whom was a black female sailor. She was a senior enlisted, so she'd been in the Navy for a while. She was married to a Marine, and they lived in Okinawa, and both were on active duty there. She was charged with conspiracy to murder her husband's mistress. That mistress was also a murderer. believe it or not, they had some affiliations to a particular gang from before they were service members. They knew some people who were involved in the Crips gang. I'm sure you've heard of them. They're pretty national. They began on the West Coast, but they are all over now. The allegations were that she got some of the gang members in the Crips to essentially pull off a hit of this mistress of her husband. And they were supposed to do that in North Carolina. But all of the communication was going on while my client and her husband were in Japan. This is a pretty big case. She was charged with conspiracy to murder and other charges attendant to that whole situation. And in the military courts, that charge can carry the same sentence as the murder itself. You'll be happy to know no one was killed in those events. And she was charged with the conspiracy nonetheless. I flew over to represent her, and I flew over as a civilian lawyer. I had been on active duty. I'd been in Okinawa. I knew the lawyers there. I knew the judges there. And I knew a lot of the personnel there. But as it was in that case, I was representing her as a civilian lawyer. So I was essentially doing like this while I was representing her back in that time period. On the first day of the trial, just the jury, the judge, the prosecutor, me and my client assembled in the courtroom. The purpose of that meeting was to make sure that there were no last minute conflicts of interest that we didn't know about, that the jury or the members, as we call them, didn't know any of the parties, did not have any interest in the matter. So the judge had to tell them a little bit about the case. He told them that there was a conspiracy to murder that was alleged. He told them about the alleged plot that they were accusing my client of committing. And they told them about the gang aspect of the plot. When asked, did the jurors have any questions? The senior member of that jury raised his hand. He was a full-grown colonel, and he would have been essentially the foreperson. And he asked if my tattoo was gang-related. Now, I was not, as you can see on that photo, as tattooed as I am now. So he may have seen a part of a tattoo under my shirt, near my neck, but it was not something that should have stood out in that way. The military judge immediately dismissed that senior juror and replaced him with one of the alternate jurors so that we could carry on with the trial. Once my client and the jury and everyone was out of the courtroom, the judge and the prosecutor and I, we had a good old knee-slapping laugh about how ridiculous his question was. Again, these were people I knew, and they knew at the time that I was, at that time, a captain in the Marine Corps as well. And I laughed with them, but it really wasn't funny to me. Here I had flown 7,000 miles to represent someone in what was probably the most serious thing that would ever happen to her. And I too was a service member, a Marine, had served in those very courts. And yet this officer was asking, was I a gang member because of a tattoo? The episode eventually caused me to go to my hotel, call a bunch of folks for whom it was an odd hour between Japan and here, vent, complain, express my outrage, and eventually try to get on with what I was there to do, which was to represent her at a full-blown trial. We did do that. I did not share my dismay and what had happened with my client, but carried on and actually tried the case. She was not convicted of conspiracy to murder. She was not sent to jail for any period of time. She was kicked out of the Navy, but we had expected that, and the goal was to keep her from being incarcerated. The next time I was accused of being a gang member, I was a judge already. This happened just a few years ago, and it happened based on this photo. This is a photo that I took in my lobby back when I was on the Boston Municipal Court. This is in Roxbury, and it's in the lobby that I occupied while I sat there. That was my home court. I took this photo one day, expecting the reaction that you just had, that it was funny. You are way too young to know the group Kiss. That's who I was mimicking. I would see this gesture everywhere. They would do it at concerts, on stage, on the album covers. I think they tried to get it trademarked. And I meant it as a funny gesture to say, hey, you can't be serious all the time. And I think I wrote something like that, and I posted it on social media. Well, someone, when I reposted it in later years, more recently, someone took a screenshot of that photo and sent it to the chief of the court that I serve on and told her, Judge Frison is throwing up gang signs on Instagram. So some part of me was flattered that someone thought I knew some gang signs, current day gang signs, but for the most part, I was obviously highly offended, and I was doubly offended that my chief would broach the topic with me. She called me one day when I was sitting up in Lawrence in the civil session just before my afternoon motions. And she said, hey, what is this picture? What are you doing? And at that time, my chief was probably about 15 years older than me. So I said, hey, this is from your era. You should know what this is. And we talked about it. She was satisfied that it was not a gang sign. And of course, it kept bothering me as I went through the rest of the day. And I wrote her an email, requested another conversation about it. And I talked to her about implicit bias and how, as one of two black judges on the court that I sit on, I'm highly scrutinized, including on social media. And my opinion was that if a white judge had posted the similar photo, there would probably not be an accusation of gang activity. At that point, I've been on the court probably 11 or 12 years. I would venture to say I'm a pretty known quantity in Massachusetts by now. And though I may be infamous, it is not for gang activity. Why do these things occur? And as you can see, it doesn't matter what status you have, how much money you make, who you are in the world. We are all affected by what we call implicit bias. I'm sure that given your interests here today, you know something about implicit bias. You may have had some training, you may have read about it, you may have seen some studies. You may talk about it in the classroom. What is implicit bias? I'm not a social scientist, so I always look back to what I have learned myself in training as the actual definition. The attitudes or stereotypes that affect our understanding, actions, and decisions in an unconscious manner. These biases, which encompass both favorable and unfavorable assessments, are activated involuntarily and without an individual's awareness or intentional control. Residing deep in the subconscious, these biases are different from known biases that individuals may choose to conceal or reveal for purposes of social or political correctness. implicit biases are not accessible easily through introspection. So sometimes you can't just think about it and determine what all your biases are. You might know some of them. You might know I like fruit more than vegetables. You might know I like the color blue more than the color black. But some biases we can't get at through just thinking about it. I am black, if that wasn't already apparent. 52 years old. I'm an American. I'm from Chicago. I'm a justice of the Massachusetts Superior Court. I practiced law for more than 14 years before coming on the bench. I'm a major in the United States Marine Corps. I'm married to a woman who is here today with me. And I have many tattoos, as you can see, on camera and off. So there are a lot of things about me in particular that you might take issue with, that you might have trigger a certain bias that you may be aware or unaware of. Sometimes biases show up in all different formats, all different forms. So it's not always about race, gender, religion, these kind of hot button topics that we discuss a lot today. It affects us in all different ways because it's the exact same brain science that we're talking about. And I like this next example because of that. How many folks in here are, I'm going to ask men, but whoever, how many folks are over 6 feet tall? Congratulations. That's awesome. Is anyone over 6 foot two? You are. And over 6 foot two? Have a closet 6 foot two.
We'll be back to back after the meeting.
So it may surprise you to know that less than 15% of American men are over 6 feet tall. That was a surprising stat for me to learn. But 60% of corporate CEOs are over 6 feet tall. And getting taller, over 6 foot two, only 4% of the American population is over 4%, over 6 feet two, which is tall. But 36% of CEOs are over 6 foot two. We got some tall folks leading businesses, right? Why is that? Is only the tall interested in leading companies? Well, how did you get to be a CEO? You don't just say, hey, I like Nike. I'm getting ready to go over there and be the CEO. Right? You know, I wish you could do that. But it's a process, and you are largely lifted to that role by taking on other roles, by showing up in leadership within that company, and getting the trust of people who work there, and shareholders. I think it has to do with our sort of innate trust in people who are taller. We think they might be smarter. They might be more good-looking. They might be more strong and protect us. They are better leaders. At least that's what these statistics imply. Because it is certainly not the case that people shorter than 6 feet can lead. Right? We know that people shorter than 6 feet can lead. However, this stat exists in this country. And I think it is consistent with the brain science that leads us to trust or distrust, to like or dislike, without really knowing all the information we should know. This is how I looked back in about 1996-ish. I look a little different now, I guess. This is when I started in the Marine Corps. This is a picture taken of me at the basic school. So this is sort of the second part of the harassment package that the Marine Corps is, and the second part of the training. The basic school is in Quantico, Virginia. And you spend about 6 months there after officer candidate school doing essentially infantry training, no matter what your specialty is going to be. So I knew I was going to be a lawyer, a judge advocate in the Marine Corps. But no matter what you're going to do in the Marine Corps, we all start in the dirt, in the mud. In this training, we're set up in companies, and then platoons, and then squads. The platoons are led by platoon commanders, and they are captains in the Marine Corps who have chosen to work at the base school and lead lieutenants through this process. My platoon commander, in my first meeting with him, where I looked essentially like that, said that when he first saw me, he asked, "Who is this person posing as a Marine?" That's what he said to himself. And then he shared it with me during my first evaluation. And at that point, I had never been insulted in that way. I was a relatively young Marine. I had just joined the Marine Corps a few years prior, was still in training. And I had, of course, done the same training that he had done. This is the type of microaggression that creates what we call imposter syndrome, where you don't feel like you belong where you are. And it may be because of what other people say or do, or what they don't say or do, or the environment. But what was amazing was that he felt superior enough that he could say who was really a Marine and who was posing as a Marine. I didn't have, at that time, the conversation I would have with him today. Oh, today we would have a Marine conversation. But at that time, I was intimidated. I was junior to him. He was my superior during this training. And I didn't know as much as I know now about these dynamics. But this is why I speak about these experiences now. And I encourage you, when you do sound off in this way about bias, you're doing it for yourself and you're doing it for all of us. Unfortunately, nothing about this topic ends with a certain age. You don't age out of bias experiences. You can't check the box, "Look, I've been through three of them, I'm done." You know, you just, it never ends. And unfortunately, during this month, I had an experience in my courtroom with a particularly irate criminal defendant on a matter that was not dispositive of his case. I was not deciding anything, guilt or innocence. I was not sentencing him. We were essentially picking dates and doing some administrative tasks on his case. He has been held in custody for a while due to his circumstances and due to the pandemic. And he was particularly upset this day. I had held his feet to the fire on one case, making him go to trial on the date that it would be scheduled, and I continued some others. He was so disruptive that I was already in the process of putting him out of the court because he would not let me speak, he would not let his lawyer speak, he would not let the prosecutor speak. So we basically were at a standstill with him just sort of spouting out all sorts of things. So while he was being taken out, he got pretty, a little bit more unruly and wanted to resist being taken out. And he started yelling out, "You fucking lesbian," to me. So I did not respond to him. I did not bring him back into the courtroom to admonish him or talk about bias or hold him in contempt and give him some more jail time on top of the detention he was already under. I let him leave the courtroom screaming that. I continued with his lawyer and the prosecutor to set the dates that we needed to set on his matter. And in fact, I've seen him again since that happened. The issues of bias in this country do not go away, and you do not escape them because you are in a certain position or hold a certain role within the community or within the country or a position of authority. But bias doesn't just make you feel bad, hurt your feelings, or put you in jail. Bias can kill. George Floyd was murdered by former Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin in May of 2020. We all were essentially on lockdown and in some ways forced to watch those brutal 9 minutes over and over and over. And it captured the nation's attention in a way that I had not seen in my lifetime. But why that specific murder, that particular mistreatment of a citizen? Why not Tamir Rice, Amadou Diallo, Eric Garner, Mike Brown, Sandra Bland, Dante Wright, Walter Scott, Freddie Gray, Laquan McDonald, Breonna Taylor, Alton Sterling, Philando Castile? We know those names, but they didn't have quite the effect that George Floyd had on us. Maybe it was the blatant and brutal way in which we watched the murder occur. Perhaps it was that we were a captive audience for once on lockdown during the pandemic, or the confluence between those two things. Either way, we are post-George Floyd now, as I call it, and we are at least directing our attention on purpose to issues that have to do with our racial history, our race relations, and the racial disparities. But things have changed then since his murder, right? Have things changed since the murder of George Floyd? I would be remiss in speaking to folks under 20 without talking about Tyre Nichols. I think it would be neglectful of me to talk to citizens of all races without talking about Tyre Nichols, and certainly to talk to the students for social justice without talking about Tyre Nichols. Once again, we were traumatized by the mistreatment and killing of black bodies, recorded and memorialized for us all to endure for what may be eternity. If you're like me, your mind is tired, your soul is tired of another complete display of inhumanity. We can talk about this killing in terms of the unit that committed it, the Scorpion unit down in Memphis. We can talk about it in terms of the significance that the officers were black and not white, and police versus citizens. We can talk about the implicit or explicit bias on the part of those officers who beat to death that young man. But talking about bias alone does not capture what is really going on in this country. As you may have heard and be listening to every day, there are some efforts around the country to tuck away parts of history, to stop teaching folks like you what I call the whole story, the whole truth about the country. We can't just look at implicit bias, because that talks about individual decision-making, actions, and feelings that we all have. We also have to look at the systems that create the warm and inviting environment for this type of violence. In the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, we feel somewhat privileged to be in a place that I think takes individual rights seriously. We are more so expanding rights than reducing rights. And we consider ourselves progressive here and protective of the inhabitants of the Commonwealth. You've seen in other states efforts to ban books. I think you're going to be talking about that in one of your workshops. Efforts to ban certain courses, like advanced placement, African American history, to ban other types of information and knowledge that students demand, like talking about intersectionality, talking about support for folks who are LGBTQ, talking about transgender violence, talking about gender-affirming therapy and treatment. There are places where those conversations and those treatments and efforts are simply ending. There is right now what I call a controversy. I call it the alleged controversy around what we call critical race theory. You may have heard this of late, and I'm surprised that this is a controversy right now. Back in 1992 through 95, when I was in law school, I was at Georgetown. I participated in a first year curriculum called the Section 3. It's one of the first year sections, and it has a broader focus than the average first year section. We talk about feminist legal theory. We talk about property and time and the different definitions of property and notions of property. We talk about current writings on legal issues, including critical race theory. Back then, it was not controversial, or not that I knew of, except to maybe the folks in our section and some law geeks. It is now heard all over the news. You hear all these politicians talking about it, or what they believe it to be. You hear people not being able to define it, but you hear people being staunchly against it. Critical race theory is different in that it looks at the actual systems that are created in this country and how they help to enforce superiority, white superiority, and how they enforce and support disparities in outcomes. If you've heard any of Justice Ketanji Brown Jackson's confirmation hearings for the Supreme Court, you may have gotten a chance to watch some of that. I did sneak and watch most of it from work. Mostly because Ketanji is my classmate. She too graduated class of 92 from Harvard. And we've both been practicing law since then. If you saw any part of the confirmation hearings, you saw congresspersons grilling her at times about critical race theory, even about the book Anti-Racist Baby by Dr. You may have noted that she didn't have a ton to say about it. In fact, when I watched it, I felt like this would be a good confirmation hearing for me, based on what I know, what my passions are, and what I speak about. But for Justice Brown Jackson, this was really not a focus of hers. Congress folk wanted it to be a focus. And to me, the tenor of the entire hearing was, okay, Justice Brown Jackson, you're going to get on the bench. You're going to be on the Supreme Court. But you better not be thinking about race while you're up there. What an odd demand in a country rife with racial disparities. If we did abolish the study of critical race theory, it would prevent us from learning about the history of policing, the history of the criminal justice system. If you've watched the 13th or 1619 Project, you've scratched the surface of what we're talking about. Mm-hmm. So you may not be able to talk about the disparities in arrest rates between black and brown people and white people in Massachusetts, let's say, without talking about the history of policing. This is a much deeper conversation than one you would have in a vacuum. If I just say, all right, everyone in this room, how many people went to school yesterday? And that's it. Well, that doesn't take into account people in the room who are not students. Doesn't take into account people who were sick or are on vacation. It just gives me some raw data. The historical context of the criminal justice system in particular is extremely important for us to understand why everyone in it now is situated as they are. When I became a judge in 2009, I was 39 years old, and the chief of the Boston Municipal Court at the time was a black man named Charles Johnson. And he brought me in on my first day at work and sat me down and he said, now, Judge Frison, I know you've been practicing law a long time in Massachusetts, so you know a lot of judges, you know how they operate, but I don't want you to emulate any of them. You cannot model yourself after any of the judges you know. You can't do the Charles Johnson when you're on the bench. You can't do the Pamela Deschelle. You got to do the Shannon Frison. I didn't quite understand what he meant, but I knew it was important to remember. And I know part of the reason that he told me that now. In 2020, a lot happened in 2020. The judges of Massachusetts learned via a study that we asked to have done of our numbers. We learned that as a whole, we are still imposing higher cash bail on black and brown defendants in Massachusetts. We are still imposing longer prison sentences on black and brown defendants in Massachusetts. Criminal cases involving black defendants are three times the percentage of black people in the Commonwealth. Black and Latinx defendants are overrepresented to a large degree in the system, in courts, and in the prisons. These are current statistics, so these aren't 1820. And this isn't one of the states that we like to talk bad about. It's not Mississippi. It's not Florida, it's not Texas, not Georgia, not Louisiana, all the places we like to bum our nose at. This is right here. And talking about the more serious cases, this is happening on the court that I sit on. Well, we had anecdotal evidence of this before. But now we have a statistical analysis that shows that Massachusetts has some of the starkest of disparities among the states. how is it that today still, black and brown people in Massachusetts do not have consistent access to justice? We also have learned overall that it's not just race, it's actually skin color, it's colorism. So that the darker the skin, the longer the prison sentence. And sometimes it is also the difference between a life sentence and a death sentence in states that have the death penalty. These are not my opinions about what may be going on. These are facts that are studied all over the country. These disparities are caused not only by an implicit bias of people like me doing the sentencing, but it's also the structure of the criminal justice system. The two are inextricably intertwined. So it makes a difference when there's a lack of diversity on the courts that are making these decisions. On the Superior Court right now, there are two black judges. So our jurisdiction includes all cases that are indicted. So these are the most serious of criminal charges. Murder, rape, robbery, home invasion, trafficking of persons and drugs. And across the Commonwealth, those most serious of criminal charges, you are almost guaranteed to be in front of a white judge. Almost guaranteed. You're looking at literally half of the black judges on the Superior Court. Wow. Consider these statistics about the women on the court. There have been a total of 77 women to ever serve on the Massachusetts Superior Court since its inception, and only 6 have been black. In 1959, the first woman was appointed. Her name was Justice Jenny Barron, and it was 13 years before another woman was appointed. In 1972, Justice Ruth Abrams. And it was even longer, 30 years before a black woman was appointed to the Superior Court. In 1989, Justice Robert Dodge O'Connor was the first black woman to serve on the court. She also eventually became the chief of the court. You may be familiar with some of those names. Justice Geraldine Hines, who eventually was on the SJC, the Supreme Judicial Court, our highest court. Justice Kimberly Budd, who is now the chief of our highest court. Justice Angel Kelly, who is also my colleague, has just ascended to the federal district. Since my appointment to the Superior Court, not another black woman has been selected to serve in the meetings. And here we see these are the women currently of the Superior Court at our last gathering. You can see that I am lonely. The other black judge on the court is Bill White. So Bill was not at the women's dinner. This theme today for you is rights and responsibilities. I want to say to you, particularly folks in your age group, you are the leaders of the future. And I think the people in this room in particular feel that, you know that, you understand it. You will make the laws and the policies, and you'll determine who has rights and what those rights are. Literally, the world is in your hands. I'm calling on all of you, I'm issuing a summons to each of you directly to do what you can to change the hearts and minds, to change some of these statistics that we've seen for the betterment of us all. And you are doing that through doing conferences like this one. I also ask you to continue to mentor some adults Learning and mentoring goes both ways at all ages. I have several younger people who mentor me, and I mentor some other people. I want you to do that because learning happens at all ages, and it can't all be in one direction. Finally, do not accept the status quo. I've been talking to you about what the status quo is. We want to change that. Everybody's going to be graduating from some places, from a few places. And we will be depending on you to continue the great work that you're going to be doing here this weekend. Have an awesome conference. And I'm going to leave some contact information. Feel free to contact me to continue this discussion or to tell me about your conquests and achievements. Thank you.